Good day. I'm Norman Wildberger. This is a series on foundations of mathematics, where I attempt to set up a somewhat new and better foundation for the subject. It's a very ambitious program, and we've just begun the subject. We've talked about arithmetic and some sort of elementary aspects of how to set that up. We've talked about geometry and some elementary aspects about how to set that up. And now it's time to go to the third most important aspect of the subject. So mathematics has really three key areas. Arithmetic is the primary one. It's the most important, historically the oldest. Geometry is the second most important and the second oldest. And the third most important and the third oldest is algebra. So today we're going to initiate our discussion of algebra. And we're going to have quite a lot to say about algebra. It's a very rich subject. And I think a lot of what we're going to say also impacts on primary school education and high school education too, as you will see. We'll also have a chance to see how to look at some very standard things in a new light, perhaps a better light. So let's start by positioning this subject roughly in terms of arithmetic and geometry. I think of algebra as forming a bridge between arithmetic and geometry. It emanates from arithmetic and it ties these two fundamental disciplines together. If I had to say what algebra was in a single sentence, perhaps simplified, I would say something like algebra is generalized arithmetic. So we take the arithmetic that we've been studying, just arithmetic with natural numbers and integers, fractions, rational numbers, the basic arithmetic involving the operations of addition, multiplication, subtraction, and division, and then we look to extend those operations and those numbers. So we're going to enlarge our idea of objects that we can do arithmetic with, and that's basically how algebra comes about. Historically, its origins probably go back to the Babylonians, but the Greeks already had a pretty good idea of algebra in a geometrical context. So as I've already discussed in the talks about Greek geometry, Euclid had a kind of geometrical algebra where algebraic expressions were interpreted and proven geometrically. Somewhat later, Nicomachus wrote an influential book called Introductio Arithmetica, in which he emphasized the importance of arithmetic essentially aside from geometry, not necessarily built up from geometry. The greatest arithmetician of the Greek times was Diophantus, who lived 250 years after Christ, and whose name gives us the subject of Diophantine equations, which are equations where we're looking for solutions purely in terms of integers, or sometimes rational numbers. He wrote a book called Arithmetica, actually 13 books together. I think some of them have been lost, but nevertheless he gives us a very thorough treatment of a lot of different problems, somewhat unrelated perhaps, and not a lot of systematic theory, but he's able to solve a lot of interesting problems, such as this one here. Find three numbers such that their sum and the sum of any two of them is a square. But algebra as a separate discipline from arithmetic really only gets going with the Hindus and then later the Arabs. So let's have a look at that development. Earlier in this series, we've already marked that Hindu mathematics was notable for their introduction of essentially our numerical system. The decimal number system that we use to represent numbers is basically a gift to us from the Hindu mathematicians, and a crucially important one. So given their very strong foundation arithmetically, it's no surprise that they were able to solve a lot of reasonably sophisticated algebraic problems. And some names that are notable are Aryabhatta, who lived around 400 AD, Brahmagupta, around 600 AD, and Bhaskara in the 12th century. So aspects of this Hindu arithmetic slash algebra include, first of all, a richer numerical system, which was quite comfortable with working with fractions, negative numbers, and also irrational numbers like square roots of natural numbers, square root of 3, square root of 5, and so on. They were very familiar with quadratic equations, how to solve a quadratic equation, and more sophisticated things too, a very important number theoretical Diophantine equation called Pell's equation nowadays, which goes back much earlier to even to Archimedes, are x squared minus, say, 61, y squared equals 1. If you try to solve that equation for integers x and y, then aside from sort of the trivial solution 1, 0, you will be challenged to find a solution if you don't know some of the theory that the Hindu mathematicians and subsequent generations discovered. After the Hindus, the torch passed to the Arab mathematicians who took the Hindu works, who took the Greek works, who studied them both, put them together, developed them further. So the name of algebra, in fact, comes from the work of Muhammad al-Khwarizmi, not sure if I'm pronouncing that right, around 1800, who wrote a book called, in Arabic, Algebra wal Muqabala, which roughly means restoring and simplification. So the kinds of things that he was referring to with restoring is this process. Say you have an equation x squared minus 3 equals 13, where x is an unknown number that you're trying to determine. Then what you can do is you can take the minus 3 away from the left-hand side, and you can restore it by essentially taking it away from the right-hand side, or adding it to the right-hand side. This is a very typical kind of basic operation in algebra. Other mathematicians, Omar Khayyam, around 1100, who was notable for being a literary great as well, wrote the Rubaiyat. He was very interested in cubic equations and showed how to solve certain cubic equations using conic sections. All right, so with that very brief historical introduction, what happens in algebra? Well, one of the key ideas, certainly, is that we're going to use letters instead of numbers, or letters together with numbers. This has a lot of advantages, and it allows general laws to be more easily stated, something that we've already done so far. It often clarifies the essentials of a problem, in that you get to see the wood, not just the trees. It leads to various higher arithmetics, especially related to things called polynomials, which are going to play an important role in algebra. And it shows the connections between different kinds of questions, that certain kinds of questions are actually very much the same. But a natural question that bedevils a lot of first-time learners of algebra is, what do these letters actually mean? What is X? What is Y? And that's something that we're going to talk about, and it turns out that it's not so simple to say what those things are, because the nature of the X's and Y's and Z's and so on that appear in algebra changes as you become a little bit more sophisticated. When you start off with the subject, X, Y, and Z have a certain role and a certain meaning, but later on that meaning changes in quite a different direction. And so there's a subtle but important shift that we're going to have to pay attention to, because we're interested in what's really going on and being precise about the basic structures and the basic objects that we're going to be using. Okay, so we're going to roughly follow a program like this to start off with. First, we're going to talk about what we might call baby algebra, which is more or less arithmetic with letters. And then we're going to move on to polynomials, and I'm going to introduce things called polynumbers, which are very closely related to polynomials, but have some interesting advantages. We're going to talk about rational functions, which are a very important field of doing arithmetic. And we're going to talk about matrices, which is another extension of arithmetic. And of course, algebra has much more in it, but probably this will be good for a first stab at what the subject's about. So next time, we are going to start with baby algebra, the algebra that students learn when they're 10, 11, 12 years old. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.